Signori, buongiorno, buon pomeriggio a tutti. Siamo arrivati a un momento, grazie. Siamo arrivati a un momento molto atteso, come dimostra la vostra presenza qui oggi. Consegniamo oggi pomeriggio il secondo Leone d'Oro alla carriera di questa 76esima edizione della mostra. Un riconoscimento che va a un personaggio adorato da intere generazioni di spettatori, come a pochi altri grandi star forse succede. Sapete di chi stiamo parlando? Stiamo parlando di Julie Andrews. Se sono due i film per i quali la sua figura è rimasta per sempre scolpita nell'immaginazione di tutti, mi riferisco ovviamente a Mary Poppins e a Tutti insieme appassionatamente, è giusto ricordare in questa occasione come lei stessa abbia contribuito in seguito a evitare il rischio di rimanere prigioniera di quei due ruoli che la volevano una sorta di icona del cinema familiare. Lei invece ha scelto di cimentarsi in ruoli di volta in volta drammatici, spesso apertamente provocatori e comunque intrisi di graffiante ironia. È il caso, per esempio, dei numerosi film che Julie Andrews ha fatto con il marito Blake Edwards, con il quale ha dato vita a un sodalizio artistico tra i più profondi e duraturi, che ricordiamo come uno stupendo esempio di fedeltà umana e professionale. E insieme naturalmente a un affascinante progetto estetico capace di prevalere sull'esito commerciale a volte di singoli film. Il Leone d'Oro è il riconoscimento doveroso di una carriera straordinaria che ha saputo ammirevolmente conciliare il successo popolare e le ambizioni artistiche senza mai scendere a compromessi. Vediamo qualche immagine tratta dai suoi film.
Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down in a most delightful way. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, even though the sound of it is something quite atrocious. If you say it loud enough, you'll always sound precocious. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Together, don't know whether it's morning or night. Only know it's sounding right. So come on in and play me the jazz hot, baby, 'cause I love my jazz hot.
Vi prego di accogliere con un applauso Luca Guadagnino che leggerà l'audazio per Julie Andrews. Grazie Luca.
Sono estremamente emozionato e farò un disastro. Il nostro ospite è inglese, quindi sarà in inglese, se non vi dispiace.
In her 1974 children's book, The Last of Really Great Wagon Doodles,
Dame Julie Andrews creates a world in which children are empowered through the gift of imagination to see and live in Wagon Doodle Land, a place where magic and miracles begin. Rain. It is through the capacity of children to use their imagination that the protagonists of the book, Ben, Tom, and Lindy Potter, eventually succeed in overcoming the challenges put before them by Proc, Wagon Doodle Land's devious prime minister, and so go on to meet the last great Wagon Doodle himself. It is clear to me that on a lifetime of tireless journeys through the realms of entertainment and cinema, Julie Andrews is that child, using the power of their imagination for all it's worth. Yet, at the same time, she herself is the magic Wagon Doodle, too, ruling her kingdom with peace, love, and sense of fun. But Julie Andrews is also a subversive artist, one who redefined her own image consistently throughout her career, reflecting time and time again and again on who and what she is. Andrews has played constantly with expectations, never finding herself in the same place twice. A child of a wartime Britain, Andrews had a very unique and unconventional upbringing, with a family she described as being one of many mothers and many fathers. First performing alongside her mother and stepfather in 1945, standing on an upturned beer crate to reach the microphone, Julie has been on stage or another since she was just 10 years old. Having already proved herself in the great musicals of London West End, Julie Andrews arrived in Broadway in 1954, debuting with Sandy Wilson's musical, The Boyfriend. That debut, like a seed in very fertile soil, became also a second debut for her, when in 2003 she staged The Boyfriend again on Broadway, this time as its director. In her musical work, Andrews' artistry expresses itself in its full power through many different aspects, from her beautiful capacity for body movement to the finely calibrated poise of her expression, but most of all through her celebrated and instantly recognizable voice. That voice described by her esteemed teacher and third mother, Lillian Stiles Allen, as possessing the rare gift of absolute pitch, was an extraordinary instrument, and it soon landed her lead roles in the stage version of My Fair Lady and eventually in Roger and Hammerstein TV musical Cinderella, the first of many staggering successes watched by more than 100 million people. The life of Julie Andrews has seen so many incarnations and so many narratives unfolding, one within each other. It was her success on Broadway, for example, that led her to be chosen personally by Walt Disney for his long-awaited film adaptation of Mary Poppins. A phenomenal hit at the time and an enduring treasure for all times, the musical earned Andrews an Academy Award. As in all great Walt Disney movies, melancholy and magic, reality and fantasy coexist brilliantly in Mary Poppins. And nowhere more so than in its splendid finale, where Julie's Poppins gives a devastating parting glance to Dick Van Dyke Berth before floating away across London on her umbrella. It's a glance that in a single gesture conveys wit, sadness, and self-determination, seeming to say, I won't be anything but that which I want to be. For her debut on the silver screen, nothing could be the same again. For her and for the entertainment industry. In iconic role after iconic role, Julie Andrews has woven a tapestry of performances that are deeply humanistic, yet simultaneously strict always with her knowing sense of humor and subtle intuition for irony. In what she says is her favorite of her movies, The Americanization of Emily, which we can now recognize as the first great satirical work of Paddy Chayefsky, Julie Andrews first played alongside James Garner, a man who was to become a very significant friend and an artistic collaborator. In this Arthur Hiller classic, she plays Emily Barham, a woman torn between her need to love and be loved after the loss of her father, husband, and brother in war, and the dignity of the truth. She has the capacity of bringing to life, with deep, empathic vibration, the contradictions of the choice she makes. Julie Andrews has never chosen to act a role just for the pleasure of acting. She has always wanted a role to have responsibilities. And for someone who claims to be indecisive, the sign, she says, of a true Libra, Andrews has always made precise and principled choices. As she writes in Homework, the forthcoming sequel to her celebrated memoir, Home, Andrews was skeptical when first approached to play Maria von Trapp in the film version of The Sound of Music, having found the stage musical Saccharin. It was only after reassurances from the film directors Robert Wise that the movie would be taking a less sentimental approach that Andrews agreed to play the role that is perhaps the most celebrated of her career. The Sound of Music cemented her status as a star of the 60s and beyond, and allowed her to moonlight as a regular face on TV, where she made beloved programs like variety show hit The Julie Andrews Hour, along with many others. Hollywood was the place Julie made her home, but it was also the place where one of the most sublime artistic love story in the history of cinema was to be forged in the late 60s. Blake Edwards, Andrew's husband for 41 years till his death in 2010, and the masterful director of films like Breakfast at Tiffany's, described their first meeting as follows. "I met Julie in a wonderfully Hollywood movie story kind of way. It started in the morning with me going into Beverly Hills and she coming out of Beverly Hills. And we would stop in the middle lane at sunset waiting for traffic and then go on. I kept looking over, and 3 or 4 mornings a week, there she would be. So eventually I said, 'Hi.' And she said, 'Hi, are you going where I think you are, where I have just been?' And I said, 'Well, I don't know what about you, but I'm going to go to my analyst.' And she said, 'Well, I've just been to mine.' So it was of all kind of meant to be. It is obvious to me that this was always destined to be a deep, lifelong relationship, beginning as it did with a shared shrink. Julie Andrews and Blake Edwards built together an exceptional body of work, starting with Darling Lily, then The Tamarind Seed, followed by 10, SOB, Victor Victoria, The Man Who Loved Women, and That's Life, and created in the process some of the most cunning, enjoyable, and layered portraits of women that we can remember. In SOB, Edwards not only fashions an outrageous and devastating satire of Hollywood, but manages to make a reflection on the iconicity of Julie Andrews herself. After all, this is a movie about an Academy Award-winning actress with a clean-cut reputation who agrees to film a topless scene in her husband's movie to ensure it sells better. It is a testament to the wisdom of Edwards and Andrews that the scene in question is an empowering rather than an exploitative one. During the 70s, along with the legendary work she made with her husband, Julie Andrews also created a wonderful collaboration with Jim Henson. Always reflecting playfully on the idea of self-representation, she portrayed herself alongside the Muppets in delightfully funny sketches. But despite her refreshing lack of affectation, Julie Andrews is an icon of the 20th and the 21st centuries, who brings an Olympic classicism to everything she does. The way in which she is embodied acting, dance, music, writing, and activism has always been at the highest of level, and her elegance has become an absolute value, unique in regard to the history of cinema and utterly inimitable. And now we arrive at the film we are going to see this afternoon, Victor Victoria, which is one of my favorite movies of all time. Julie Andrews plays Victoria Grant, a struggling soprano singer in the 30s Paris who plots with her newfound friend Toddy to take over the city music scene by pretending to be a male-female impersonator, Count Victor Krasinski. This leads Andrews to play not one, but 2 characters in a performance that constantly shifts our conception of the self and the direction of our desires. In fact, this movie, wild and brilliantly funny to watch, is also a great example of the power of cinema to play with identity and to ensure that the impossible is made possible. In Julie Andrews' performance in Victor Victoria, we see all the power of ambiguity, all the power of humanism. I'm reminded of the title of another great Julie Andrews Blake Edwards movie, That's Life. For me, that describes the art of Julie Andrews, the art of life. Please welcome Dame Julie Andrews.
Signore e signori, Julie Andrews.
Oh, thank you so, so much. That is the most wonderful welcome. Thank you. And thank you, Alberto, and thank you, Mr. Baratta, for the beautiful gift of your beautiful golden lion. And thank you, Luca. I'm amazed how much he knew. But I am also a big fan of yours. So thank you and good afternoon, everybody. Buon pomeriggio, right? When I was a child growing up in England, I sang many arias in Italian. But the problem was, I was so young, I hardly understood a word that I was singing. So I would try for, you know, a folie, folie, you know, I can't even remember all the words now. Del Rovano e questo povera donna, you know, sola band. And I'm thinking, what am I singing about? What am I saying? But so I think today it would be better for everybody if I speak in English. Forgive me. It is such a pleasure to be here today at the Biennale di Venezia and to receive this phenomenal honor, the Golden Lion, which is also, I am told, the symbol of this beautiful city which I adore. It is especially meaningful that this honor comes from probably the premier film festival in the world today. As I look at the film selections this year, I am reminded once again of the power of film to connect and to unify us all. And I consider myself so blessed to have spent a large part of my professional life in the cinema arts. I still marvel at the fact that I was the lucky girl who was asked to play those wonderful roles. I would like to take a moment also while I'm here to acknowledge the vast amount of young talent that is emerging today in the film industry. I ask them to please stay true to their vision and their dreams. The rewards and the spirit of community will be immeasurable. Lastly, I want to thank you and all the audiences here and around the world who remain so passionate about the value of the cinema. You make all of this, all that we do, possible, and your continued support keeps the magic alive on the screen for all of us. So grazie mille, thank you again. I send you all my warmest wishes and my love. Thank you, thank you.
One last picture with us. Luca. Grazie, grazie ancora. Vi lasciamo con le immagini meravigliose di Victor, Victoria.
I just want to say that I do hope now that you will all enjoy the film that is coming next, which is Victor Victoria, which was directed by my husband Blake Edwards and was a great joy. Enjoy the film.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that.
Yes,
it's very heavy, so be careful.
Yes, it is.